Well, everyone doing well?
Yeah.
I want to ask you just a question here. Does Almighty God have your undivided attention right now? Okay, awesome. So we are, last weekend was opening weekend for football, right?
Yeah.
You guys fired up about any fired up football fans here?
Woo!
Anybody? Yeah? That's cool. That's cool. I did something that I don't normally do, and that was last weekend. We went over to Granny and Mimi's house, and we watched a little football. My wife and I, we don't have cable, so we got this black box on our entertainment system. We still haven't figured out what it's for, but it does play Redbox movies. But we went over, we started watching, we watched the Pats and the Arizona Cardinals. That was a pretty good game. Anybody hate Tom Brady up in here?
Yeah.
There's a couple of Tom Brady haters. Well, I watched that game. At least I watched some of it. It was a pretty good game, though. Who else has a favorite team? Anyone else have a favorite football team? Who is it? The Gators. You have a football team, too? Ooh, a house divided, huh? You sit next to each other still? That's cool. You give her the business, you know, every once in a while. Who else? What do you got? The Giants, too. Who else?
The U.
The U? Another one of you? Wow. Who?
Packers and Vikings.
Packers and Vikings. Isn't that a conflict of interest?
I was born in one state, raised in another.
I gotcha. Bandwagon guy. So, who else? Ohio. Ohio. So, it is football season. I'm not really a Patriots fan. I grew up in New England, and so... You know, I have an affinity for them a little bit. I just because, like, on the right night, you can actually, when the wind's blowing, you can actually hear the murmur that, you know, what is really loud in the stadium. You can actually hear the, it kind of sounds like Charlie Brown's mother, right? From a distance, you can hear the announcer if the wind is blowing just right. I lived in the next town over from Foxborough Stadium, so we could hear the Patriots playing. And so I was kind of a Patriots fan. But ironically, when I was a kid, you know, with a name like Moses, there wasn't too many of me around. So one day when I was, you know, pedaling around on my bicycle out in the streets of Sharon, I saw this little trading card on the ground, right next to the sidewalk. And I picked it up, and it was a trading card for a football player, and his name was Haven Moses. So I thought that was kind of cool because I didn't know any Moses out there, but he was a Denver Bronco. So I just kind of became a Denver Bronco fan just because of the name. And it just stuck, you know, although I'm not a fanatic for football, really. I do like the game, but I'm not a crazy freak for football. You know what I'm saying? Like, as a matter of fact, I'm from the next town over from the stadium, but I really only know of one player on the Patriots. And I really don't, it's Tom Brady. Like, I don't know him, though, right? I can say I know him, but I don't really know him. I know of him, right? I've never met the guy. I've never shook hands with him. We've never had a conversation. I've never bumped into him, although that would probably hurt. I've never bumped into him in a restaurant or around town. I don't know a single player, really, on the New England Patriots. It's not like the team is, like, stocked up with a bunch of my old cronies from my hometown because, I lived there. And so, you know, maybe some of the guys grew up playing some Pop Warner football or something. Then we got a little bit older and went to high school and college. And then the Patriots rounded them all up, all the local guys, and started playing on the team. And I'd have a vested interest in them because they're my buddies. Like, that didn't happen. I don't know anybody on that team. And so it's funny because no matter what happens on a week in and week out basis, I will, no matter whether they win or lose, doesn't matter how well they play or how bad they play, I will never earn a single dollar or lose a single dollar based on the record of the New England Patriots. I will never lose a moment of my life. I will never gain a moment of my life. I will definitely, definitely not ever lose a moment of sleep, whether they win or lose. You know, it's kind of pathetic. Grown men watching their football team. And if they lose, heaven forbid they lose, don't talk to me. It, like, ruins the whole, like, it's the worst day ever to have football. Because if your team loses on Sunday, the whole rest of the week is ruined for work. Like, grown men, well, maybe they're not grown after all. You know? Taking shots. Well deserved, I'm sure. to anyone who would let that, listen, why would it affect you that much, right? My team lost. Do you think anyone on that team even knows you live? And but yet we are just so wrapped up in, like, I'm not here to rip football. I like football. It's a good game. I like to play football with my buddies, right? I'm sure, certainly not going to spend $200 to go pad someone else's pocket to go watch them play. Heck nah, right? Not happening. But it happens. So here's the thing that's kind of weird. Like, if I don't know a single player on that team, like personally, why would I even root for them? Why would I pour out my resources to them? And I'm not talking about just money. I'm talking about time, my spirit, right? We're supposed to worship in spirit too. We're supposed to pour your spirit out on something, and I'm pouring it out. I'm ripping on the Gators. Go Gators! Like, obsessed, sick, crazy Gator people and Seminole people and all these, like, crazy, obscene. Like, wake up in the morning and start doing this. No, how about brush your teeth? That'd be nice. You know what I'm saying? Like, obsessed with this stuff. And why would I be so obsessed with that if I don't even know them? Why would I root for them like I do? And so, of course, I was thinking about that, and I'm getting ready for this week, you know, and I started thinking about that. And the same thing holds true for Jesus. Like, why would you follow Jesus? Why would you want to be in his family? Why would you want to identify yourself in his family as one of his followers without any firsthand knowledge of him or without any first-person encounters with him? Why would you want to do that? Why would you? I want to know who this guy is, right? I want to know who this guy is. This, the most famous person to ever live on this planet. I want to know who he is. I want to know who claims to be Lord. I want to know this guy who says, believe in me, because if you've seen me, you've seen the unseen sovereign creator of the universe. I want to know who that guy is. I don't want to assume anything. I don't want to assume anything. I want to know who he is. And so that's the question. Who is this guy, Jesus Christ? And you know, that's a biblical question. So you know, if you're asking that question, it's not like you're doubting or anything that's like it's bad. It's actually biblical. In Luke chapter 8, we're going to study it in a couple of weeks, there's a story of Jesus, and he's with his disciples, the guys who follow him, just like his students, and they're copycatting him. They're doing what he does. They're going where he goes, trying their best to do what he says to do, but they fail. Don't leave me up here, right? And so these guys are fishermen, right? This is crazy. These guys are fishermen, and they fish every single day in the Sea of Galilee. And they're in their boat, the boat that they're in every single day. And listen, these aren't big, massive boats. These are boats about the size of the stage, if that. And they're in this boat every single day. And in the Sea of Galilee, if you're fishing there every single day, you think maybe you'd get kind of used to the environment, the storm patterns, the seasons, all that kind of stuff, if you did it every single day, right? So these fishermen are in the boat, and they're in that same boat, in that same sea, every single day, and the storm starts to brew up. And these fishermen that are in that boat that they're in every single day, they know exactly what's going to happen. A storm so big says that the waves are crashing up over the boat, and they feared for their life. So if you know these fishermen are in that boat every single day, year after year, doing the same thing, and this storm scared them to death to the point where they thought, they're freaking out. We're going to die. How bad do you think that storm was? Come on, right? Pretty bad? Really bad? Yeah. Jesus was sleeping. So here's trained, expert, experienced fishermen in their boat, in their lake, and they're freaking out. We're going to die. We're going to die. Oh, wake up. He's sleeping. Jesus is cool, man. Jesus is so cool. They wake him up, and they're like, Lord, we're going to die. We're going to die. And he's like, yeah, you're pathetic. You're not, just, dude, seriously? Come on. Don't you know who I am? You know, wouldn't you like to be that guy? Like, right? Come on. It's like, remember, anyone ever watch Happy Days? You remember that? The old people in here? Remember when Fonzie went to go comb his hair? He's like, pfft. That's what Jesus probably did. He probably stood up and went, pfft. right? So what does he do? He goes to the edge of the boat, just like I'm doing right here. And he looks at, and the waves are crashing over the boat, and the people are freaking out like crazy. The wind's blowing like crazy. And Jesus goes, stop. And it goes, boom. So after they cleaned up themselves, they said, now listen, Jesus had done miracle, right? Read the book. Read it. Miracle, 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 miracle. And these guys are all watching this stuff go down. But that one floored them. They're like, who is this guy? That he speaks, like, if you speak to a person, if I tell you something, you can comprehend it. Give me a glass of water, right? Here's some water. Stop moving. It can't comprehend what I'm saying, can it? But the water in the Sea of Galilee did. It comprehended the power and the authority of Jesus, and it stopped. Like, the storm stopped. And it didn't slow down. It stopped. And the people are like, who is this guy that even the winds and wave obey him? Listen, creation submits to the Creator. And he's the Creator. And the wind stops, the waves stop, and they're freaking out. And so they're like, who is this guy? So if you're asking that question tonight, you're biblical, man. You're biblical. In order to give yourself over freely to worship of this Jesus, I'm just telling you, you got to know some things. You got to know some things. And that's what we're after. That's what this series in Luke is all about. See, back in the day when Jesus was roaming the earth, the people, they actually interacted with him in person. Okay? They interacted with him in person. So they saw what he did. They heard the words of his mouth, like his flesh mouth, like I'm talking right now. They heard him teach. They heard him rebuke. They heard him encourage. They heard him teach God's word. But now it's a little bit different. It's a little bit different because he's not here like that now. Like, he's not here in the flesh. Jesus Christ was wrongly accused. He was put up on the cross. He was killed. He was buried into a rich man's grave. He rose again in 3 days. And then he ascended to heaven where he sits at the right hand of the Father. And he's preparing a place for you to come and be with him someday. But when he went up there, he loves us, so he's like, I'm not going to really leave you. I'm leaving you, like, physically, but spiritually I'm not, because I'm going to send my spirit, the spirit that's in me, that raised me up from the dead. I'm going to take that spirit, and I'm going to send it down to live inside of you. So we don't have Jesus Christ in the flesh here right now, but what we have, you know, we have his word, amen? And so that we know exactly who he is, and we know exactly who we are, and we know exactly how we're to worship him, and how we're to live, and how we're not to live. And then we also have his spirit, so that we can understand what the word says, and then also so we can discern the things that are not necessarily in the word to see if they're actually from the Lord or they're from a deceiving spirit. So that's what the Holy Spirit. So we do have that advantage. But here's the other thing that we have. We have TV, and we have internet, and movies, and family, and friends, and they all have opinions. Everybody's got an opinion. I don't want to talk about opinions. But what I will say is that you and I, because of this, we need to work hard to navigate through all of the information that's available to us in this information-crazed culture that we live in. We have to navigate, and we have to go finding truth so we can know who he really is. Because, listen up, true worshipers worship him in spirit and in truth. Right? I got to pause there for a second. I'm going to say it again. True worshipers worship him in spirit and in truth. Are you a true worshiper? Before you shake your head, God's word said something. True worshipers, like the ones who really worship God, the ones who are in relationship with Him, He is their Father. He is their Father. They are His children. They have been saved. The Holy Spirit lives inside of them. They worship in spirit and in truth. So I'm just saying that if you want to know, there's some objective evidence right there if you know if you're saved. So if you're in here and the worship begins to the music starts to play, right? Come on, somebody. Right? True worshipers worship in true worship. Listen, if you're in relationship with God the way He wants it, you're showing something. You ain't flatlining, right? You're showing, there's a boop, 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 you're clapping. You're singing, you're dancing, you're raising your hands, you're crying, you're yelling, you're something, you're worshiping in spirit, right? You're showing, so true worshipers worship in spirit and in truth. And I'm not saying that every single person's going to be going like this and woo, glory to God. But however He's made you, kick butt with that. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to pick on you a second here, Philip, because I love you and we go way back. I can do this, right? Look at it. He's in a chair, right? He's got braces on his legs. Probably not going to do a whole lot of dancing, right? But I guarantee you, I've seen it because we've been worshiping together for years now. Quite often, I'll look over and he's going like this. He's doing what he can, right? He's worshiping the Spirit. He's a little fired up. Listen, I'm a little fired up about Jesus, right? I'm fired up about Jesus. And so when I don't see someone fired up about Jesus, I get a little fired up with them. I'm sorry, but I just can't help it, right? So I'm a little fired up about Jesus. I hope you're a little bit fired up about Jesus as well. But maybe there's not much spirit because you don't have enough truth. See, it's the truth of who God is. It's the truth of God's word that fuels the spirit. When you know who Jesus is, you can't help but go crazy. You can't help it. You can't help it. And we need a little truth up in here because we need a little spirit up in here. The world comes in and they see a group of people that are just loving Jesus. They're going to be like, what in the world is going on with them? But I don't know, but I want some. And they're not drunk. Well, some of them may be, but that's beside the point. I don't forget our roots. We need a little truth to fuel our spirit. And I need a little drink to fuel my throat. So the question is, who is this guy? Who is this guy? So let me tell you a little bit of what the Bible says about this guy, right? In Isaiah chapter 9, verses 6 and 7, listen, jot that down. Jot the reference down. Jot it down, jot it down, jot it down. Look at it. And if you have a Bible, you can go there if you want, but I'm going to kind of breeze through these real fast. But jot the reference down, take notes, learn, grow, advance, let the kingdom advance in your heart. Don't waste your time here. Make it worthwhile. Prophet, amen, prophet. Isaiah 9, 6 and 7, it says this, that the government will rest on his shoulders. Like, this isn't just like the government of the United States. You know why he doesn't mention a specific country? Because it's the governing of the world. Everything will rest on his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor and Mighty God and Everlasting Father and Prince of Peace. And his reign, not only is he mighty God, but his reign is eternal, it says. So he's the mighty God of the universe, and it's forever. That's power, man. That's power. Now, also in Luke chapter 2, we discussed this a couple weeks ago. The angel of the Lord shows up, and he speaks. I don't know what the angel of the Lord looked like, but it was big and it was bad, man. Because he said, don't be afraid. So it wasn't like your little emblem that you have hanging on your little rearview mirror. Look at this, that's my little guardian angel. He protects me from I-4. That's not what it's talking about, because who's afraid of that? I'm a little afraid of rabbit's feet. That's cruel, y'all. Right? But the little angels, like, why would the Bible say don't be afraid? Unless it was big and bad and scary, right? So the angel of the Lord shows up, and he's also speaking of this one, that this mighty God, this one that will be the governor of all the world forever. And he says to the shepherds, he says, the Savior, the Messiah, the Lord has been born. So the Bible says that this one who's coming is going to be mighty God. His reign will last forever. He's the Lord. He's the Messiah. He's the Savior of the world. And so finally this Jesus shows up. And he makes this amazing assertion in Matthew 16:18. This Jesus, this one who is going to reign forever and be the mighty God of the universe, he says, I'm going to build my church. My kingdom's going to grow. I'm going to build my church. And hell can growl. Let me see your growl. Let me see what you got. And it can show its teeth. But it better get some Polydent, because I'm going to kick it in its teeth. And I'm going to win. I'm going to win. That's an amazing assertion. In this little town by this one dude to this little group of people. So let me ask this, we're in the campaign season, right? So he's about to launch this campaign that's, now listen, let's go back. What did he say? It's the government of the world will rest on his shoulders. It's an eternal, universal reign. That's a big campaign, right? That ain't no president, right? So that's a big campaign, and he's about to launch this campaign. And if you're going to launch a campaign of that magnitude, you better have a plan, right? You better have a plan. And so we see in Luke chapter 5, and I want you to turn there, grab a Bible. Grab a Bible. If you don't have one, there's plenty of them in the seats in front of you. Grab one. Put your eyes on God's Word. Don't just listen to me because I got a microphone. Everything I say from this pulpit, I want it to be from God's Word. Okay? And so that's what I want you to do. I want you to open up God's Word and see that what I'm telling you is right there in writing and that I didn't make anything up. Anyone in here want to be part of a church where the pastor makes stuff up? Anybody? I don't. And I hope that you won't either. And I endeavor to support everything I say with the Word of God. So Jesus is going to launch his worldwide ministry that's going to last forever. It's going to prevail. Nothing's going to stop it. And so we see it. And who does he go after? Bono? Bon Jovi? LeBron James? The Pope? I mean, the people of influence and power, right? I mean, that's what we do now. I mean, we're saying no, but isn't that what everybody does now? You go after the people that have prominence and a voice and a platform and have money and influence, the celebrities, right? That's who you go after. Is that who Jesus goes after? Let me tell you who he goes after. A fisherman, a leper, a paralyzed dude, and a hated tax collector. Worldwide reign forever. Now, I don't know about you, but God already knows your heart. You can admit that's kind of silly. That wouldn't be what I would do, right? I'd go get Oprah and Bono and Bon Jovi. Right? I mean, come on, right? That's what I want to do. If I wanted to get people up in this church, how many people would think that, you know, maybe get someone famous up in here and we could, you know, put it on Facebook. Hey, this guy's going to be here. This girl's going to be here. And we'll draw the crowds. That's not what Jesus did. He went straight after four people that in the culture meant nothing. And I would just offer you this, that even today, not much has changed. Not much has changed. And you know what's really neat about that, those four guys? That gives me hope. That gives me hope, right? I mean, I believe that I'm saved. I believe that I have a relationship with the Lord Jesus. I believe I'm going to enjoy glory forever with him, right? I absolutely believe it. But truth be known that even though I believe I'm saved, there's some days that I go, well, I don't know, man. I've done this and I've done that and all that, right? So I have some, anyone else ever have any doubts? Even though you know what the Bible says, but you still have a little bit of a doubt. Like, maybe I'm just kind of that crappy that I'm not good enough. And maybe you're here tonight and you're in that place like, I'm not quite sure that I'm good enough, that God would love me and God would pursue me and God would allow me to get into the kingdom. Maybe I'm just not good enough. I want to tell you the truth. You're not. But He is. And so these people here, there was nothing in them that qualified them, if you will, to have entrance into the kingdom of God. But Jesus Christ, He still goes after them, right? He goes after them. And so perhaps this gives you a little bit of hope too, that, you know what, if he'll come after people like that, he would come after a guy like me. You know, he would save a car salesman, maybe. I don't know. But I see this and I'm like, yeah. He might. So perhaps you're not the privileged person in our culture today. Maybe you're not the exalted one. Maybe you're not the honored one, the highly admired one. Maybe that's not who you are. Maybe something about your upbringing makes you kind of lesser, like viewed lower in our society. Maybe it's something about where you live, or maybe it's your wallet, or maybe it's your skin color, or maybe it's the job or the career that you have. People don't look at your job and go, wow, that guy's amazing. He's a janitor. He's a, I don't know. Maybe it's the car you drive. People don't brag about your 1999 whatever with 300,000 miles on it. You know, that's not something, man, when I grow up, I'm going to have a 1999, Plymouth Sable or whatever, Mercury Sable with 300,000 miles on it. I can't wait. Like, no one's drooling over my car with the skin cancer all over the paint. I mean, it just doesn't, right? You know what I'm saying? Some of us have a different kind of car, though. Glory. Maybe it's the neighborhood you live in. Maybe you're not living in the most opulent, gated community with the beautiful mint pad and all the granite countertops and the best tile and all these big pools and all that kind of good stuff that people envy and look up to. Maybe it's your level of education. Maybe it's your skills. Maybe it's your looks, right? In our world, we have this model of what we're supposed to look like, and everyone's shooting for that. Everyone's shooting to, all the ladies want to be like the models who have legs that look like this. That's gross, dude. You need a little meat on the bone, you know what I'm saying? You need to give, I've seen them, some of them girls on TV, they need to give them a stinking cheeseburger or something. I don't know what it is that makes you feel inadequate, but perhaps the way others view you, or even the way you view you, isn't the way you should. Because Jesus said that He's the way. So maybe you need to look at you the way that the way looks at you. Amen. You know what I'm saying? And that's what He was doing when He was looking at these people, a fisherman. Like, listen, a fisherman back then is different than a fisherman now. Even the grungy fishermen get their own stinking TV show now. They're loaded smelly people. But today, in our world, listen, if you're a fisherman, it's because you have, most likely, it's because you have a, I'm talking about the common people, I'm talking about the regular population. It's because you have a really good job, and you have either too much money, or you're too stupid, and you put a big boat on credit, and you go fishing in these Mac Daddy Boston Whalers. Center console, big old Mac Daddy, awesome boat, right? Okay, that's not what these people were. These people had like smelly robe. Listen, they're fishermen. They stink. They smell like fish guts, right? And they're not in these luxury, boats with all the best gear, And what are those shirts that breathe? What are those things? Oh, man, the fishermen shirts. All the fishermen have them. What are they? Something like that. Pastels. Right? The pastel colors, like light green, and they breathe, and they get the best outriggers and all. I don't even know what outrigger is, but I want to use that, you know, and because I saw it on a show, right? So they got the, and depth finders, I know what that is. I know what that is. And they find the fish finders and all this awesome equipment. And like, these guys didn't have that. They had wooden boats and they were freshwater. They were freshwater. This wasn't out in the ocean. This is a little, it's like a lake, dude, right? Sea of Galilee, it's like that big. And they go out there and there's a group of guys and they get out there and they stink and they're uneducated. Most of them were probably illiterate. They didn't have any money. They were dirty. They smelled. They were gross. And that's who Jesus goes after, right? The leper, right? Highly contagious skin disease and a social and religious outcast. Like, you weren't allowed to mingle in the temple where people were worshiping God because you were what they call ceremonially unclean. You couldn't stand in the presence of God because you were diseased, you were nasty. And so you couldn't come in the temple, and you couldn't even dwell within the city gates where the normal clean people are. And if someone who was clean ventured outside the city gates, it was the social responsibility of the leper to be looking out for that, because if someone normal came by, the leper had to go, unclean, unclean, unclean. I'm bad. I'm nothing. I'm gross. I'm an outcast. I'm less than you. Stay away from me. That's what they were made to do. Jesus went right after that guy. How about the paralyzed guy? The paralyzed guy, and this is sad, but it's like that today. They're not contributing to our society like the normal person would. They're not going to maybe have a job. Maybe they're a burden on our government and our tax programs, and we have to pay for them because, well, you can't work, so you can't contribute, so you're a burden to us. You're also religiously unclean too, because back then they believed that it was sin that brought disease and sickness and blindness and deaf and paralyzed to the body. And we know that because it says in the scripture that there was this blind person, and the religious leaders would go up to him and up to his parents and say, why is he like this? Was it your sin that did it, or was it your sin? See, that was the assumption. That's what people believed, that because of sin that they were diseased or paralyzed or sick or something like that. So they weren't allowed to worship with you guys because they were no good. They were second class. And Jesus went right after him. And the tax collector. I know the tax collector around here. He's actually a really godly man. Bob McKee, great dude. If you know him, you know. Good dude, right? Yeah, this guy wasn't like that. Matthew was not like that. Matthew, if you don't know, here's a little history for you, okay? Matthew is living in a time when Rome invades and conquers and destroys Israel. And Matthew is a Jewish dude that sides with Rome and collects taxes from the Jewish people to fund the opposing army that's oppressing his own people. How popular think he was? Not only that, but he was dishonest, because this is how they used to do it back then. The Roman government would say, okay, tax collector Tom, when you go to Leesburg, I need you to collect $5 from every person, okay? Okay, but anything over $5 you can keep. Give a man that leeway, right? So what does he do? Hey, Rome said that when I come to you, you have to give me $25. And you have to give me $25. And anything over $5, he got to keep. So he's financially raping his own people to fund the army that's killing them. You think he was loved? And Jesus went right after him. Who is this guy? If the real Jesus, the Jesus of the Bible, is anything, he's compassionate. That's the truth. You want to know who Jesus is? He's the King of compassion. Do you know, if you read the Bible, you will find that it's never Jesus saying, "What can you do for me?" It's always Jesus saying what? What can I do for you? The King of the universe, what can I do for you? That's crazy. That's crazy. That's who Jesus is. Let's talk about compassion. Let's talk about whether it's supported in Scripture if Jesus Christ is compassionate. Amen? You got your pens out? God's got your undivided attention? Jot down these verses. Matthew 9:36. Matthew 9:36. The story here is Jesus is traveling from town to town. He's preaching God's word. He's healing people of all their afflictions. He's going from here to there and here to there. He's very busy with the work of the kingdom. And it says in verse 36 that when he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were confused and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. Now listen, Jesus doesn't come into the town and sees the absolute, what we would consider the most downcast, wretched, suffering, like, he's not talking about that. He walks into a town, he doesn't just look at the guy sleeping under the bridge. He looks at the town, and he looks at the people, and he says, they're confused and helpless. Listen, did those people in those towns have religion? Did those people in those towns have a government? They have Rome. Did those people in those towns have family? So what you're admitting to me is that they had some type of structure and support system in their lives that they could fall back on and look to for identity and help. And yet, Jesus looks at these people and he's looking at us because we're those people and he's like, I have compassion on them because they're confused and helpless. Because all those things that you put your identity in, all those things that you put your hope in, they're nothing. And it made him sad. And moved with compassion, he brought healing to them too. You see it again in Matthew 14:14. Look at this here. John the Baptizer, who Jesus loved, is beheaded. And the news of this reaches Jesus Christ. And because Jesus Christ has a heart, he's upset. You lose your best friend, wouldn't you be upset? If you lost someone you love, would you be upset? Kind of be a bummer, right? Well, Jesus Christ is God, but he's also man. And so he says he gets into a boat to be alone. So I don't know exactly what happened in that boat. You know, I mean, here's the Bible over here and here's me over here. I'm just telling you that if he gets alone in the boat, why is he getting alone in the boat? Maybe he wanted to mourn? Reasonable? Pray maybe? That's reasonable. So he just lost a dear loved one of his, and he gets alone, and he prays, and he's mourning, he's saddened, you know? But the crowds don't leave him alone. The guy's a rock star. And they find him out in this boat. Can you see Jesus just out there? Just by himself, just kind of getting into a little canoe kind of thing and just paddling out there and just want to be alone. Do you ever want to be like that? Just kind of be alone. Just hang out with the Lord. Quiet, right? So that's what he was doing. But it says the crowd found him. And even in that time when he was so burdened for the loss of his loved one that he adored this guy, the Bible says that there was no greater man ever than John the Baptist. That's high accolades from God, right? So he means something to Jesus. And even in this time when he is so focused on his own pain and loss of his friend, when the crowd finds him, he steps from the boat and he even had compassion on them then. He wasn't thinking about himself. He was thinking about them. And because he had compassion, it says that he healed their sick. I love this one. Matthew 20:34. Jot that down too. Two blind guys on the side of the road. Some more people that our world would probably not look at and say, you know what? He could be a good president. Yeah, that's probably not going to happen. So there's two blind guys on the side of the road, and They can't see Jesus coming, of course, but they can sense that there's something going on, because by now there's a great crowd following Jesus everywhere he goes. And so you can kind of feel it, right? Here it comes. You feel something coming down the road, and maybe you hear a little bit of a murmur like the Patriots Stadium. But it gets louder and louder and louder, and they've heard that this Jesus, this miracle worker, is going to be coming to town, and you can hear the parade and the shouts and the yelling. And all of a sudden, these two blind dudes, social outcasts, sitting on the side of the road, they start screaming, "Lord, Son of David, have mercy on us!" So what happens? Every time somebody gets riled up for Jesus the way we ought to, the world says, "Shut up. Quiet down, man. Don't yell Jesus in church." It's supposed to be reverent. You get the ear pulled, you know, ooh. We should practice. You guys want to practice that?
Yes.
Why don't you yell out Jesus one time for me? Go ahead, let me hear what you got.
Jesus!
I don't think that's all you got. Let me hear one more time.
Jesus!
The first one was better. So you know what? They did what we should do when someone tells you to shut up.
Jesus!
That's right. Lord, Son of David, have mercy on us. So what does Jesus do? What do you want me to do? Right? Shouldn't it be the other way around? He's the king. Any other time there's a king, anywhere else on the earth, right? What happens? They're sitting on their high throne, and you come in, and you get down, you kiss their hands. And Jesus is totally the opposite. He comes down to you. What can I do for you? That's crazy. That's crazy. He says, "What can I do for you?" And what do you think the guys are going to say? "We want to see. We want to see." I can't imagine what's going through their mind, but I'm thinking right now, I don't know about you, but I'm thinking right now, what do they really want? Are they burdened about their sight, or they just so badly want to see this Jesus? They want to see this man. That this man is passing by. There's a fleeting moment in life that you didn't want to miss, and they so badly didn't want to miss it. We want to see. And Jesus says that Jesus had compassion on them, and he touched their eyes. Listen to this. This is so crazy. They were healed instantly. Back then, those people that are diseased with leprosy and illness and blind and deaf, they were like cooties, you know what I'm saying? So the religious people stayed away from him. Jesus was a rabbi. And he goes up to the leper and meets them where they are, comes to them. It's like a regular dude wouldn't touch them, but a rabbi to go up to them and touch them, like, ah! Jesus didn't care what anyone thought. And so I think it was Jessica earlier said, it doesn't matter what anyone else thinks around you, worship him. Right? Jesus sets us the example. He goes up and touches the people with cooties. And he doesn't care what anybody thinks because he loves them. So he goes up and he touches their eyes and they're instantly healed. Listen, if Jesus is anything, he is a man of compassion. You know what compassion really is? It's this thing inside of you where you can literally sense someone else's pain. And that sense is so mighty that it moves from here to here into your nerves and muscles, and it makes you do something about it. I'll pray for you. No, you won't. If I'm hungry, feed me. I love you. Give me a Big Mac. That's all I'm saying. If I'm hungry, you can pray for me. We'll pray over the Big Mac. Is that cool? Get me a Big Mac. Moved by compassion. See, he's moved, right? It's not just a word that they just threw in there to fulfill her. He was moved with compassion. That means he felt something and it made him do something about it. He's a man of compassion. And that's who we're to be. Jesus followers follow Jesus. I think I said Christ followers follow Christ. And so if he's compassionate, what are we supposed to be? Compassionate. People in our community should know us by our compassion. They should know us by our compassion. I want you to know that you guys, right here, remember a few moments ago when the offering plate came by? Some of you gave, some of you didn't. I have no idea why, that's not the point. I'm just saying. But this week, a lady called our church. She has three kids, and that deadbeat man, one child he left her, then they just had another one 6 weeks ago. She came home, he was gone with all their money. And she has no idea where he is. And you paid her rent.
Amen.
You paid her rent. So that mommy who has a full-time job and that little baby that's 6 weeks old isn't living under a bridge. See? Moved with compassion. I'm just doing it on your behalf. I have your heartbeat. Like, I know you would have said yes. That's compassion. Not, yeah, miss, I'm going to protect the name. Yeah, miss Mary, we'll pray for you. That's awesome. How much you got in your account? Moved with compassion. Moved, right? Moved with compassion. Do something. So let's, you get that?
Yeah.
Moved with compassion. Okay. So let's switch gears a little bit and for just a moment, and let's talk about how Jesus deals with compassion with these four people, okay? Let's see what compassion looks like with the fisherman, with the leper, with the paralyzed guy, and with the hated tax collector. A little word association, right? So when you think about someone who's compassionate, let me throw a few words at you, and you tell me if you think that these work. Generally speaking, if you think of someone as compassionate, would you say that they're kind? Would you say that they're nice? Would you say that they're generous? Would you say that they're gentle? Would you say that they're loving? Okay, I would too. Let's see what this Jesus, who is compassionate, nice, kind, gentle, and loving, let's see how he deals compassionately with these people. So look at Luke chapter 5, and let's read a little bit. Are you there? Okay, we're just looking at God's word. He's got your attention, right? Okay. One day, right at the beginning. I'm asking you this as your pastor. I love you. I want you to surrender right here. Put up your white flag and surrender. This is the word of God, right? I will submit to its authority, and I will listen and I will obey it. Listen, this is what I want to do. You don't have to put up your flag, but that's, I hope, the posture of your heart right now as you read God's word. It's not just a book, okay? One day as Jesus was preaching on the shore of the Sea of Galilee, great crowds pressed in on him to listen to the word of God. I love that, man. Pressed in, like, great crowds pressed in, like, I want more, right? I want more of God too. Do you guys want more of God? I want to experience him more. I want to see his kingdom grow more. I want to see his power manifested more. I want to see people by the thousands loving Jesus. Oh, drives me crazy. Okay, so they're preaching. He's preaching and they're just crowding. Like, oh man, that would be awesome. He noticed two empty boats at the water's edge. He looks at details. Jesus sees details. I just got that. That's cool. He noticed two empty boats at the water's edge, for the fishermen had left them and were washing their nets. Stepping into one of the boats, Jesus asked Simon, who's Peter, we all know him as Peter, really, its owner, the boat's owner, to push it out into the water. So Jesus sits down in the boat and he taught the crowds from the boat. That'd be kind of cool if we did that one day, right? Kind of cool. Just trying to be Jesus. Just trying to be Christ-like. Just trying to be, we're going fishing. So he teaches from there, right? When he had finished speaking, so he preaches something, and it doesn't say what it is, but when he finished speaking, he said to Peter, "Now go out where it's deeper and let down your nets to catch some fish." Verse 5, "Master," Simon replied, "we worked hard all last night and didn't catch a thing." Do you think we could take the Bible literally? I think so. So how many fish did they catch? Nothing. A lot of fishing, not a lot of catching. "But if you say so, I'll let the nets down again." And this time their nets were so full of fish they began to tear. A shout for help brought their partners in the other boat, and soon both boats were filled with fish and on the verge of sinking. Okay, so there's three things here you have to notice. The first one is that Jesus preaches a sermon. Like, I don't even know what it's, it doesn't say, right? So we could speculate all we want of what he said, but he preached a sermon. Okay, so what's an average sermon? Anywhere from 30, 40, 50 minutes, I don't know, an hour or something. I mean, how long did he talk? How long did Jesus talk?
An hour.
Just on an average, right? An hour. He spoke for an hour, and when the sermon was over, he looks right then and there, he looks at Peter, and he says, "Now go out where it is deeper and let down your nets to catch some fish." You know what that is? A command. No suggestions. He didn't say, "You know what? I think the bass are jumping. They're biting, man. Now would be a good time. I got the fishing report. I looked at the farmer's almanac. Now's a good time. Trust me. What have I ever done?" No, he didn't do any of that. What did he do? Command. Now, listen, I don't know what he preached. But I do know this. The Bible says that whoever you choose or whatever you choose to obey becomes your master. And in that moment, within that hour, this Peter who just met Jesus, he decided that Jesus was his master. And he obeyed the command. And he said, "Listen, you know, Jesus, that's my boat. Hey, don't you have excuses when you open the Bible and it says to do something? You're like, you know, it'd be kind of tough to do. Don't leave me hanging up here, man." Right? I mean, high bar, right? Bible's high. I didn't mean that. The Bible has a high bar. And so sometimes we have some fears and doubts. I mean, I think that's why it's in here, just so you know it's okay to have some fears and doubts. Right? That's why it's in here. So Peter, he's an expert. This is what he does for a living. "This is my boat. This is my lake. I fish here every day. I kind of know what I'm doing. And I fished all night and I didn't have any luck at all." So he's got some doubts, right?
Yes.
But, if you say so, I'll do it.
Amen.
Oh, we sang a song. Can you bring up that last song? Bring up that last song. What was that last song? "Jesus, draw me close." Keep going. Right there, look. Read it out loud. "Jesus, draw me close, closer, Lord, to you, for I desire to worship and obey." Did you mean it? Or did you just sing a song? Did you feel it? It's true. Don't bring a fake offering to your king.
Right.
If you're going to sing it, mean it. If you don't mean it, do not sing it. Don't sing it. He takes no joy in someone who doesn't keep his vow. And so the command is put the boat in the water and go out there and put your nets down. We have some doubts. We have some fears. I'm an expert. I think I know what I'm doing. But if you say so, I'll do it. And look, the command is sent out, the obedience is immediate, and the reward is plentiful. That's compassionate Jesus. That's how he attacks the heart of Peter. Right there. If you look in the Matthew account of the same story, Matthew expands in one way. Immediately following this story of the fish all jumping into the boat. I'm thinking of Sesame Street. You guys ever see that? You know what I'm talking about? Here, Percy, 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 Percy! Right? Come on. And Ernie does it, and it works. And Bert is so mad. He's like, Percy, 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 Percy! And no fish jump into the boat. That's all. I'm so sick. That's what I think. I have way too many kids. But in Matthew chapter 4, it immediately says, Jesus looks at him and doesn't offer any more suggestions. He says, come follow me and be my disciple. And he immediately drops everything that is his and gone to follow Jesus. That's what he does. Immediate obedience. Obedience. How about the leper? Ooh. When we were in high school, remember? Girl germs. Shh. Remember that? Was I the only one who did that? Shh. Okay, maybe middle school. I'm old. I don't even remember high school. The leper, right? Be healed! That was it. Jesus commands the disease and the leper's body to fall in line with the will of the Creator. And wham, it's done. That was it. Listen, creation obeys the Creator. Do you know what the only thing in all of creation that doesn't obey the Creator? Raise your hand. It's this and this. The body had no option of not obeying. Jesus, listen, here's the thing. I noticed this week. We always say that Jesus like looked at the leprosy and called it out. Did he really? Would he tell leprosy to be healed? That's, no. Who is he talking to? The person, the body. You wouldn't tell leprosy to be healed. You can't, a disease can't be healed. The person can be healed. He spoke, the Creator spoke to the human flesh and said, be healed. And immediately it was. That's Jesus Christ. That's Jesus Christ. Jesus commands the man. Don't tell anyone what I just did. And go to the priest and bring your offering. And the man obeys. But it does say that reports of him, of what happened, see, that's not the person talking, is it? The news reports what happened over there to someone else. I don't report, I tell. News reports, others report of what happened. So other people report, so more fame, more glory to God. But the man obeys. Be healed, done. How about the paralyzed man? So here's the paralyzed. This is the one of the best stories in all the Bible, right? So here's this paralyzed dude. I don't know the extent of it, but he can't walk. He can't do this. And so he's got two buddies. So you have to use your imagination a little bit. Grab a couple of like long poles, right? Probably metal to support them, maybe some thick wood, and some type of cloth or burlap or something with maybe some wood under it. And they've constructed this thing to carry this man around. He can't walk, so he's not contributing to the society by any means. He's not working. He's not contributing to the tax base. Right? He's not offering a good or a service to the community. He's a burden. And these guys carry this man to where Jesus is, who's preaching in this house, and it's so crowded. I love that. It was so crowded. Say amen. Oh, man. I have visions of Billy Graham crusades and people are just coming down to the Lord, man. That's just insane. So he's so excited. People are so excited that they have to press in, and they go to the house, and these guys are so eager to get to Jesus for this guy to be healed that they can't get in. So they they climbed up on the roof. Now, how much does this dude weigh? I don't know. Conjecture. What's a paralyzed dude gonna weigh? At least 100, right? At least 100. Full grown man, at least 100. So we got a 100-pound guy on this this makeshift cart thing and two guys, and they actually do all the work, envision it, of carrying this man up on top of the roof of this house and start ripping shingles off the top of the house. And there's Jesus, like I am right now. I'm not Jesus by any means, but here he is, and he's preaching the word, right? And all of a sudden, what in the world? And the flakes are coming down, and they used to use like mud and duty and stuff on that, on those roofs. I mean, honestly, so here's this duty falling on the Creator. That's not cool. But he's preaching, and all of a sudden the stuff comes down, and he looks up, and there's a hole opening up in the roof of the house, and they're lowering. I mean, can you imagine this? They're lowering the guy into the house. Long story, you should read it. But at the end of the day, this is what he does. He looks at the guy, and he says, "Stand up, pick up your mat, and go home. Stand up, pick up your mat, and go home." And immediately the guy jumps up, picks up his mat, and goes home. Immediate obedience. And when you're immediately obedient to the Lord, blessing, he's healed. He's healed. He's healed. I love this about the people are there, right? They have no idea. We've seen some amazing things here today. Really? Duh. You know what's amazing? Immediate obedience to God. I'll tell you, that's amazing. How often do you see that in your own life? Don't look at the guy next to you going, "You see? How about you? How about me?" Like, forget all y'all for a minute. How about me? How about the man in the mirror? Don't make me sing it. Right? That's where it starts. Woo! That's where it starts. That's what's amazing. That's why you're like, "Yeah, we've seen some amazing things here today." Yeah, actually, someone who's obedient to what God says, that's different. That'll preach. Thank you, because I can't make up my own stuff. How about Matthew, the tax collector? This story has a massive place in my heart, because this is where our church started. So Jesus goes to this nasty old tax collector that everybody hates, and he's like, "You should come follow me and be my disciple." Like, I wouldn't have picked that guy, but Jesus did, and that's what we're praising him for tonight. It's awesome. It gives us hope. He's incredible. But anyway, this is what happens. So immediately he follows him, but then after he follows him, I don't know what happened, because it doesn't say in the Bible, but somewhere along the line, there, Matthew has a house somewhere. It doesn't say if they went back to that same town, or maybe he was loaded because he was stealing everybody's money. So maybe he bought another house in another town, wherever they went. I don't really know, but it says that Matthew had a party, a dinner party at his house, and he invited Jesus and all of his disciples. And then Matthew says, "I'm going to invite all of my buddies that are all crooked, rotten, awful tax collectors that everybody hates, and we're all going to hang out." Well, you know what? Just like all the time when you want to come in and really be authentic and hang out with Jesus, you get religious people that come in and call you a devil worshiper. Y'all, some of you know what I'm talking about, right? They just show up all the time. I don't know why, man. They just So they show up, and the religious folks are looking, and they're like, "Man, I can't believe it. Look at it. We're clean and we're awesome. Look at my robe, and look at my tefillin, and look at my tassels. They hang all the way down to the ground, and I'm awesome. And I got a little curly things and a big hat, and you should be like me. And I know I memorized the Bible. I'm an idiot, and I don't want to help you, but I know this by heart." And so they look at all these regular folks like us, and they're like, "Why does your teacher eat with such scum?" And that's when Jesus, who's an awesome leader, let me tell you something, good leaders, great leaders, they step forward and take the first punch. They don't hide in the back like a stinking coward. They lead the charge. And he steps forth right then and there, and he cuts them right off. He says, "Healthy people don't need a doctor. The sick do. I came to save those who are sinners, not those who think that they are righteous." Well, that's a stinger right there, right? That's who he came for. People who know that they're hurting. Like, you know, the people who just, I have a new sense here in our church. I'm tired of like babysitting people that think they don't need to be here, then don't. I don't care. But you know what my prayer was over there when you guys were all singing? I was like, Lord, pour out into those that are in here that want you right now. Those are the ones that you're going to build your church on. Those are the Peters. Those are the rocks right there. Not the people who were sitting there going, oh, why wouldn't you come tonight? Whatever. See ya. There's nothing I can do about it. I can't make them come. I can't. But there's people that really want him. And so he says to this nasty old tax collector that everybody hates, follow me and be my disciple. You know what that is? Another command. And so Matthew stands up. It says it. He leaves everything and he follows him. If we're going to worship Jesus in spirit and in truth, we got to get some truth about him from this. Anyone ever heard of the 10 suggestions? Right, because they don't exist. What was the number one mandate that God has ever given the human race? Someone went up to Jesus and they knew the 10 suggestions. And they said, Jesus, of all these things here that you've got, that you tell people, what's the most important thing? And he says, to love the Lord God with all your mind, heart, soul, and strength. That's the number one thing. Do you know what the guy said? He said, what's the greatest commandment? Maybe we need to reevaluate what love is. Maybe you're all waiting for some lovey-dovey tingle inside your heart before you'll be obedient. It's a commandment. How do you command someone to love you? If it's truly a light and happy little, this feeling that you're going to get inside of you that one day will sprout up because God did it and now you're going to respond, why would you tell that thing, why would you command that thing to love? You don't need to. Why would you command something that's going to just do it naturally? Jesus, God, commands that you love him. Maybe love's not a feeling as it is a choice of your will. Something to think about? What's the greatest commandment, Jesus? Nobody wants to preach about obedience. No, well, I mean, you don't go to a church and there's an expression. People have told me that I should be an evangelist, and I don't buy it. But there's an expression in the evangelist world, and it's a privilege of the evangelist because they don't have to deal with you guys. So they come in, they freaking hammer you with some truth, and then they leave. They call it blow in, blow up, and blow out. That's what they say. They can come in and they can teach you the hardest lessons in all of Scripture, and they don't have to worry about whether you like it or not or whether you leave the church because they're already in Alabama. Have you guys ever listened to Billy Graham preach TV? Yes. My Lord. My Lord. That guy stands up, doesn't matter what he twists it like. He stands up and says, you are a sinner and you need Jesus Christ. Come. And they come like freaking cattle, like by the thousands. I've never seen anything like it in my life. Never. And it's never anything interesting. You are a sinner. And the bow of God's wrath is upon you. And you need Jesus Christ. He's made a way. Now you come. Wham! It's amazing. So I'm not the evangelist, but I'm your pastor who loves you. And so this message I've got to be true to the text. I have to be true to God, and I have to be loving to you and tell you the truth that nobody wants to hear about obedience, but you need to know about obedience. You need to be preached about obedience because obedience is not something anyone likes. We don't want to be obedient to our parents. We don't want to be obedient to our teachers. We don't want to be obedient to our pastors. We don't want to be obedient to the policemen. We don't want to be obedient to our government. We don't want to be obedient to anybody. And you don't need to tell, I don't need to stand up here and tell you not to be obedient. You're awesome at it. The Bible says to obey your spiritual leaders, for they must give an account for you. Make it easy for them, for that would be good for you. So when I tell you something, You're supposed to, but 9 out of 10 times you won't. Because it's in our sinful, broken nature to disobey. That's who we are. It's the air we breathe. So when I stand up here and I encourage you, I say, listen, Jesus went to church every single week. You should come to church every single week. Do as Jesus did. Christ followers follow Christ. Come here every week and serve. And the next week, we had the lowest attendance we've had in a year. So I'm just saying it because it's proof you're all disobedient. And I am too. That's just who we are. Nobody wants to hear a message on obedience. Tell me about something better. Tell me about something that's going to be good for me. Man, this is so good for you. This is so good for you. In 1968, Frank Sinatra sang a song that is the theme song of our disobedience. I did it my way. I couldn't get accurate results in statistics, but when it was released in 1968 in the United Kingdom, over there in Britain, it was in the top 40 for 75 consecutive weeks. Why is that? Because people of the Enlightenment, of which we are, love to do it our way. They don't want to be told what to do. Nobody wants to sit in a church and be hollered at and be told what to do. But if you read the words of Jesus, that's exactly what this man of compassion did. Paul tells Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 4 to his young preacher protege, he says, preach the word. Just preach the word. Tell them about Jesus. Preach the word. Why? Why? Timothy would say, why, sir? Why would I do that? He goes on to say, because there'll come a time where people don't want to hear that. And they're going to gather around them teachers that will tell them what they want to hear. People want to hear about the God that they think he should be. They don't want to hear about the God who barks out commands and expects obedience. They don't want to hear it. But I love you too much to sugarcoat it. Don't tell them about the God they want him to be, but tell them about the God that he really is. Who wants to be commanded, right? But listen, loved ones, I brought this up for a reason. This is very, very true. God's greatest blessings flow into your life through the funnel of obedience. Right here. If you want blessing, it comes through the funnel of obedience. You can't circumvent that system. That's the way he has it set up. Do you have scripture? Someone asked me if I have scripture to back that up, please. I really do. Because I'm asking you to do something that's hard, right? So you don't want just some creative little guy to make up some. Do me a favor, turn to Deuteronomy chapter 28. You have God's word in front of you? Deuteronomy chapter 28. I'm going to read to you 14 verses. That's what I like to hear, man. Anyone wish we could do this all night? Mm-hmm. Huh? You can sleep if you want. Go to sleep right there. This thing's driving me crazy. Does it feel cooler in here this week? Air conditioning's finally fixed. Praise the Lord. Took us 6 years to do it. This is good, man. I remember nights just preaching in the chapel and also in the little building down the road where I was up here doing my thing, and I just feel it just pouring down my body. I'm like, oh, this is hell. It was awful. But this is good, man. This is good. You guys ready to read God's word? All right, here we go. You ready? What was my claim? God's greatest blessings will always flow through the funnel of obedience. That's what I said, right? Here we go. If you fully obey the Lord your God and carefully keep all his commands that I am giving you today, the Lord your God will set you high above all the nations of the world. You will experience all these blessings if you obey the Lord your God. You ready? Hold on, you gotta do this. Come on, do this. Ready? Here we go. Your towns and your fields will be blessed. Your children and your crops will be blessed. Your offspring and your herds and flocks will be blessed. Your fruit baskets and breadboards will be blessed. Wherever you go, whatever you do, you will be blessed. The Lord will conquer your enemies when they attack you. They will attack you from one direction, but they will scatter you from you in seven. The Lord will guarantee a blessing on everything you do and will fill your storehouses with grain. The Lord your God will bless you in the land he is giving you. If you obey the commands of the Lord your God and walk in his ways, the Lord will establish you as his holy people, as he swore he would do. Then all the nations of the world will see that you are a people claimed by the Lord, and they will stand in awe of you. The Lord will give you prosperity in the land he swore to your ancestors to give you, blessing you with many children, numerous livestock, and abundant crops. The Lord will send rain at the proper time from his rich treasury in the heavens and will bless all the work you do. You will lend to many nations, but you will never need to borrow from them. If you listen to these commands of the Lord your God that I am giving you today, and if you carefully obey them, the Lord will make you the head and not the tail, and you will always be on the top and never at the bottom. You must not turn away from any of the commands I am giving you today, nor follow after other gods and worship them. Amen. Do you receive?
Amen.
But I'm not going to read it. But you know, if you don't, it was a dry erase board. It's gone if you don't.
Well, that was the Old Testament. We're not under the law no more.
Well, Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. So you read the right book. But you maybe want to have a New Testament thing, right? Well, that was Old Testament. It's not like that anymore. We're not Israel. Colossians chapter 3. 22 through 25, God's Holy Spirit speaking through Paul to slaves. Who wants to be a slave? Nobody wants to be a slave. Slave. Life sucks. Slave. And what does he tell? He tells the slave to work as unto the Lord, not to your taskmaster. And remember, if you do, like he didn't suggest that, hey, you know what? You know, I know this guy's kind of a jerk. And you know what, if you just kind of conjure up in your own mind and imagination that somehow he's not a jerk named Bob, but he's actually got a robe and flowing hair and he's sandals and it's Jesus. Like, if you just make that up in your mind, you'll feel a lot better about your day. No, he didn't say that. He issued a command. Work as unto the Lord. And remember, he says, but listen. Remember I said there was a command, there's obedience, there's reward. What does it say? 22 through 25. Remember, he's going to reward you for it. There's always a reward when you obey his command. There's blessing and reward resting in the palm of Almighty God. It's resting in his hand, and he desires to fill your boat with fish, to open up the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing upon you if you will choose to obey his commands. Well, some might say, again, like I said earlier, that first you have to fall in love with him, then you start doing what he commands, because then you want to. I get that. It's a lot easier for me to do something for my wife if I love her. I get it. But that's just not the God of the Bible. We'll call the worship team back up. But listen, Acts chapter 17, verse 30. Can I just tell you what this verse says? It says, in times past, listen up, don't look at them. In times past, God would overlook your religious ignorance. But in these last days, he commands everyone everywhere to repent of sin and turn to him. He commands it. It's not predicated on whether you fall in love first. God doesn't give many suggestions at all in Scripture. 2 John 1:6 says this for the one who thinks you need to fall in love first. And this is love. He's about to give you the definition of love. You ready for it? Who wants it? You want it? And this is love, that you walk in obedience to his commands. Revolution, in your name is a definition. It's a radical, momentous shift in the status quo. And the status quo in our world is that obedience is a negative. Because it rubs against our self-centered nature. It robs us of our perceived independence, and it wars against our entitlement mentality. But what do you have that God has not given you? See, belief or not, whether you love him or not, that does not negate the command of a mighty and holy God, who commands that you turn from your sin and obey him. The holy shift that we need is we need to view his command a little bit differently. We need to view his commands as the greatest show of love from this compassionate God that you could ever dream of. Because when he commands you to do something, it's because it's best for you. So it's not bad. So when the preacher gets up and says, I'm going to preach about obedience tonight, don't go, oh man, can we preach about like prosperity or how I can make some more money or good stewardship so I can pay my mortgage off or something like that? My kids are rebellious. I don't know what to do. Man, obedience is awesome. Obedience is awesome. Not only is the Creator worthy of our obedience, and that it's proper, but as clearly stated in God's word, God's greatest blessings will flow through the funnel of obedience. So I ask you, what has God commanded you to do? In our church, I've been saying this for years now, we have this little three-part, little catchphrase, I guess. And it's, open it. Right, we got that part, hopefully. Read it and do it. But sometimes the do it part, right? Sometimes there's something stuck up in there, Right? Trying to put oil in the car and there's something stuck down in there and it won't flow. The do it, your do it is jammed. Your do it is jammed. So what's got your do it jammed? What has he told you to do? Do me a favor. I love you. Do me a favor. Do this. Be a funnel. You know what this is? This is you. You don't have to do it. I'm just asking you to do it. You don't have to. This is a symbol to God right now that you realize that there are blessings that he wants to give you and that you truly want them. Right? That you truly want them. Keep them up. Keep them up. Keep them up. I'm going to read you a quote and then we're going to pray. A.W. Tozer once said that it's altogether doubtful whether any man can be saved who comes to Christ for his help with no intention to obey him. All right, loved ones, let's pray. Keep your hands up. Keep your funnel up. Father, we don't have any idea of the abundant blessings you want to open up the windows of heaven to pour out on us. But we want them. I want them. You guys want them? I want it. I want everything you got, God. everything you would want for me. If you're a loving father, a giver of good gifts, I want every single one of them. Someone say amen. Right? But Lord, our doer is broken. It's congested. It's stopped up. Our doer's stopped up, Lord. There's something in the way, and it's our disobedience. If your word is true, and we believe that it is, that all of your blessing and reward comes straight to us through the funnel of obedience, then unstuck our doer. Speak to us now, Lord. Tell, what is it? What is it right now that is blocking our doer? Point out so we could do something with it. Lord, I want your blessing. I want your reward. I want your blessing for these people whom I love. I want your reward for these people who I love. I want them blessed. I want their relationships blessed. I want their homes blessed. I want their kids blessed. I want their health blessed. I want this church blessed. I want their mortgages to disappear like mine did. Woo! And I want that for them. I want everything for these people. But I don't want it nearly as much as you do. You want so much for these people if we would just obey. So Lord, I pray that you will inspire us right now. Inspire us once and for all to dig deep, to go after you, Lord, to be obedient to your commands, to open that awesome book, that love letter you sent to us, and read your commands, and once and for all, to just be like Peter. Lord, I'm scared. I'm not sure this is going to work out. I've tried it before and it didn't. But if you say so, I will do it. I want our boats filled with fish. Amen? Amen. Father, thank you so much for tonight. Lord, we just want to worship you one more time before we leave. Thank you for that opportunity to do so. I ask for your blessing on all of these amazing people, all these beautiful faces. Use them as a beacon of hope to your world out there as we go. Bless our time together here. Let it be productive. Let your kingdom advance in our hearts tonight. And we're ready, Lord. We're ready. We're ready for you to fill our boats. In Jesus' name. Amen. Love you guys.